It was a face that had been lived in. The chin had taken a few left hooks. The mouth had curled around a chair's stale wisecracks. Under the brim of a beat-up fedora were the dull, flat eyes of a man who used to care. His name was Eddie Valiant, and he was watching a cartoon. It was an R.K. Maroon production starring Roger Rabbit and Baby Herman. In the cartoon, a refrigerator had just landed on Roger's head with a crunch. When the refrigerator door swung open, Roger peered out, surrounded by tweeting birds.
Cut!
A human director stepped onto the movie set.
Cut, 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 cut!
Roger!
What's this?
A tweeting bird!
A tweeting bird! Roger, read the script. Look what it says. It says, Rabbit gets clunked, Rabbit sees stars. Not birds, stars!
Please, bro, I can give you stuff. Look!
Roger hit himself over the head. There were exclamation points, a cuckoo clock, but no stars. Behind the cameras, at the back of the soundstage, Eddie Valiant looked on. He pulled out a flask of whiskey and took a jolt, shaking his head in disgust.
Tums.
Valiant put away the flask and headed upstairs to the office of R.K. Maroon. The studio chief got right to the subject.
I'm 25 grand over budget on the latest Baby Herman cartoon. You saw the rabbit blowing his lines. He can't keep his mind in his work. You know why?
One too many refrigerators dropped on his head.
Ah, he's a toon. You can drop anything you want on his head. He'll shake it off. But break his heart. Goes to pieces just like you or me. Read that.
Maroon handed him the morning edition of the Toontown Tattler.
Seen cooing over calamari with not-so-new sugar daddy was Jessica Rabbit, wife of Maroon cartoon star Roger. What's this got to do with me? I don't have time for this.
Look, Valiant, his wife's poison, but he thinks she's Betty Crocker. I want you to follow her. Get me a couple of nice, juicy pictures I can wise the rabbit up with.
Where does she live?
I don't know. Toontown, I guess.
Forget it. I don't work Toontown.
Whoa, fella. You don't want to go to Toontown, you don't have to go to Toontown. Nobody said you had to go to Toontown anyway. The rabbit's wife sings at a joint called the Ink and Paint Club. Toon Review. Strictly humans only, okay?
The job's gonna cost you $100.
$100? That's ridiculous.
So's the job.
All right, you got your $100.
Maroon wrote out a check and handed it to Valiant.
Where's the other 50?
Let's call the other 50 a carrot to finish the job.
You've been hanging around rabbits too long.
Valiant borrowed a camera from his girlfriend Dolores and headed for the Ink and Paint Club, where he found a table next to the stage. Sitting behind him, wearing a silly grin and a loud suit, was Marvin Acme. Besides making movie props like whoopee cushions and exploding cigars, Acme was the owner of Toontown. Suddenly the lights went down and the curtain parted. Standing in the spotlight was Jessica Rabbit. Valiant was surprised to see that she wasn't a rabbit at all. What she was beautiful.
You had plenty of money, 1922. You let other women make a fool of you. Why don't you do right? Like some other men do. Get out of here and get me some money.
As she sang, Jessica strolled to Valiant's table, where she gazed at him and threw herself into his lap.
Why don't you do right? Like some other man do.
She hopped off Valiant's lap and slipped behind the curtain. When the lights came up, Marvin Acme got to his feet. He slicked down his hair, picked up a bouquet of roses from the table, and disappeared backstage. Valiant checked to see if anyone was watching, then followed him. Behind the curtain, Valiant saw Acme knock on a dressing room door. After a moment, the door opened and Acme went inside. Valiant hurried out the back door into an alley where he peered in the dressing room window. His eyes widened. Then he pulled the camera out of his pocket and began taking pictures. Later that night, in R.K. Maroon's office, Maroon and Valiant watched as Roger Rabbit looked through the photos.
I just don't believe it. I won't believe it. I can't believe it. I can't believe it.
Believe it, kid. I took the pictures myself. She played patty cake.
Roger took another look. The photos showed Jessica and Acme seated knee to knee, caught in the act of slapping paws. They were playing patty cake.
The kitchen light of my life. The apple of my eye. The green of my coffee. Somebody must have made it do it.
Now drink this, son. It'll make you feel better.
Maroon handed him a drink, and Roger emptied the glass in one gulp. A moment later, there was a loud rumble, and Roger's head turned into a tomb steam whistle. Roger zipped off the desk, crashing through the blinds and out the window. Valiant examined the rabbit-shaped hole in the glass.
Well, at least he took it well.
Valiant collected the remaining $50 and went back to his office, where he fell asleep at his desk. Early the next morning, he was awakened by Lieutenant Santino of the Los Angeles Police Department. Santino informed him there'd been a murder.
Marvin Acme. The rabbit cacked him last night.
What?
Santino drove him to Acme's gag factory in the heart of Toontown. Inside, among boxes of toon gags, a large black safe was embedded in the floor. Nearby was a lifeless body of Marvin Acme.
Just like a toon to drop a safe in a guy's head.
There was a noise behind him. Valiant turned around to see a black-robed figure with the features of a vulture and the chalky complexion of a cadaver. It was Judge Doom.
We talked to Mr. Maroon. He told us the rabbit became quite agitated when you showed him the pictures. The rabbit said one way or another, he and his wife are going to be happy. Is that true?
Hey, pal. Do I look like a stenographer?
I'm surprised you're not more cooperative, Mr. Valiant. A human has been murdered by a toon. Don't you appreciate the magnitude of that? Since I've had Toontown under my jurisdiction, my goal has been to rein in the insanity. And the only way to do that is to make toons respect the law.
As Judge Doom spoke, a toon's shoe tumbled out of a carton and rubbed up against his leg. Doom picked up the shoe and carried it over to a paddy wagon, where two of his weasel helpers uncovered a large drum of liquid. Valiant turned to Santino.
What's that?
Remember how we always thought there wasn't a way to kill a toon? Mm-hmm. Well, Doom found the way. Turpentine, acetone, benzene. He calls it the dip.
I'll catch the rabbit, Mr. Valiant. Then I'll try him, convict him, and execute him.
Doom lowered the shoe into the drum, where inch by inch it dissolved into nothingness. He held up a pink-stained glove.
They're not kid gloves, Mr. Valiant. But this is how we handle things down in Toontown.
Later that day, Valiant trudged up the stairs to his office. In the hallway outside his door was a baby carriage. Baby Herman sat inside, puffing on a cigar.
Look, Valiant, the rabbit didn't kill Acme. He's not a murderer. I should know. He's a dear friend of mine. I tell you, Valiant, the whole thing stinks like yesterday's diapers. Look at this. The paper said Acme left no will. That's a load of succotash. Every toon knows Acme had a will. He promised to leave Toontown to us toons. That will is the reason he got pumped off.
Has anybody ever seen this will?
No, but he gave us his solemn oath.
If you believed that that joker could do anything solemn, the gag's out of you, pal.
Valiant pushed the carriage down the hall and unlocked the door to his office. As he tossed the newspaper onto his desk, he noticed something about the photo of Acme. There was a piece of paper sticking out of his back pocket. Valiant got his original copy of the photo and examined it through a magnifying glass. On the paper were the words, "The Last Will and Testament of Marvin Acme." Thinking about this new information, Valiant loosened his tie and pulled a retractable Murphy bed out of the wall and flopped down on the bed and rolled over. He found himself nose to nose with Roger Rabbit.
How did you get in here?
Through the mail slot. I thought it would be best if I waited inside. Steady! Pull me out, you're making a big mistake.
Take your hands off the door, will you?
I swear, this whole thing's a setup. A scam, a frame job. Okay, sure. I admit it. I got a little hot under the collar when I first thought I'd pick the deputy. So I rushed over to the Incan.
paint club to theater, but she wasn't in the dressing room, so I wrote her a love letter.
Wait a minute. You're telling me, in a fit of jealousy, you wrote your wife a love letter?
That's right. I noted she was just an innocent victim of circumstance.
I suppose you use the old lipstick on the mirror routine, eh?
Lipstick, yes. Mirror, no. I found a nice, clean piece of paper. Dear Jessica, how do I love thee? Let me count the waves. 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000.
Why didn't you just leave the letter there?
Obviously, a poem of this power and sensitivity must be read in person, so I went home to wait for her. But the weasels were there waiting for me, so I ran.
So why come to me?
Everybody knows when a tune's in trouble, there's only one place to go. Valiant and Valiant.
Not anymore.
Playfully, Roger picked up a pair of handcuffs and fastened Valiant's wrist to his own.
Eddie Valiant, you're under arrest.
Yeah. Idiot. I got no keys for these cuffs.
There was a screech of tires outside. Yeah. Roger dragged Valiant to the window.
Yeah. It's the Tomb Patrol! Hide me, Eddie! Please!
A moment later, 5 weasels burst into the office. They found Valiant at the bathroom sink with his hands in a basin full of suds.
Hello, boys. I didn't hear you come in.
Okay, wise guy. Where's the rabbit?
You mean the rabbit with the orange pants, the big floppy ears, the buck teeth, and the clodhopper feet?
Yeah.
Haven't seen him.
Search the place, boys. And leave no stone unturned.
The weasels turned the place inside out, finding nothing.
Come on, boys. Let's ask.
Valiant pulled a waterlogged Roger Rabbit out of the sink.
Gee, Pathetti, I was thrilled. You saved my life. How can I ever repay you?
Stardust, don't ever kiss me again.
Across the street, Valiant's girlfriend Dolores was serving drinks at the terminal bar when Eddie walked in. There was a mysterious squirming bulge in the sleeve of his trench coat. He discreetly pulled back his sleeve to reveal Roger in the handcuffs. Nodding, Dolores led him to a back room where he pulled a hacksaw out of a tool chest and started sawing. While he worked, he showed Roger and Dolores the snapshot with a big circle drawn around Acme's back pocket.
So that's what this little drama's about. Mr. Acme's will.
Yeah.
Anything I can do?
Maybe you could go downtown and check the probate.
Yeah, check the probate. What's that?
When the courts decide what happens to a dead man's estate.
Valiant finished sawing off the handcuffs, then threw them aside and stood up.
Can he stay here for a couple of days?
Not gonna do anything crazy, is he?
I ask you, does he look like he'd do anything crazy?
Late that night, a meaty fist punched out a window in Jessica Rabbit's dressing room. The window opened and Eddie Valiant climbed silently inside. Using a flashlight, he searched drawers, dressing table, and closet. Finally, in the wastebasket, he found what he wanted. The blue cover of a legal document labeled The Last Will and Testament of Marvin Acme. Eagerly, he pulled it open. The will was gone. As he looked up, he saw a dark shape looming over him.
Oh, no.
Then he saw stars. When he came to, he was looking up at Judge Doom, Jessica, the weasels, and Bongo, the gorilla security guard. The giant gorilla glowered down at Valiant.
Take it easy, Bongo. We'll handle Mr. Valiant our own way. Downtown.
Downtown? Fine. Let's get a hold of Santino. I'd be more than happy to go downtown.
Oh, I'm not talking about that downtown. I'm talking about downtown Toontown.
No, not Toontown.
The weasels threw him into the paddy wagon and drove him to an eerie tunnel leading into Toontown. Early the next morning, strange sounds came from the tunnel. Eddie Valiant came rocketing out as if shot from a cannon. There was a burlap sack tied over his head and arms. Behind him, the weasels emerged holding paint cans and brushes. Valiant ripped the sack off, revealing a tomb pig painted over his head.
Oh, God.
Ah! Ah, no! Ah, I'm in Tuna Road! Ah!
He went back to his office, scrubbed the pig's head off with turpentine, then showered and dressed. As he came out of the bathroom, he found himself face to face with Jessica Rabbit.
You've got the wrong idea about me, Mr. Valiant. I'm a pawn in this, just like Roger. Can you help me find him? Just name your price, and I'll pay it.
I bet you would. You gotta have the rabbit to make the scam work.
No, 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 I love my husband. You've got me all wrong. I'm not bad. I'm just drawn that way.
She walked over and hugged him, burying her face in his shoulder. Just then, Dolores walked in through the open door.
Dabbling in watercolors, Eddie?
Goodbye, Eddie. My offer stands firm. Think about it.
She blew Valiant a tune kiss that floated across the room and stuck on his cheek. Then she sauntered past the smoldering Dolores and out the door. When she was gone, Dolores peeled off the kiss, crumpled it up, and threw it in a wastebasket.
Well, do you want to tell me what she was doing with her arms around you?
Probably looking for a good place to stick a knife.
Oh, come on, Eddie.
Dolores, come.
Dolores shook her head angrily and stormed out the door. Valiant was right behind her.
Dolores, listen to me. Look, I want you to go out. I want you to buy yourself a new swimsuit. Because you and me are going to Catalina. I'm on the verge of wrapping up this case.
No, you're not, Eddie. That's what I came to tell you. I stopped by probate. Maroon's not after Toontown like you thought. It's Cloverleaf that wants to get their hands on Toontown. They put in the highest bid. And unless Mr. Acme's will shows up by midnight tonight, Cloverleaf is going to own Toontown.
What? As she spoke, a faint melody floated toward him from the terminal bar.
Roger.
They raced into the bar, where they found Roger Rabbit, using the bar as a stage for a song and dance number.
My buddy Betty Dee, a sour cooking fiend, but when I'm done, he'll leave the gun to the joker he will be.
Valiant grabbed Roger and hustled him into the back room.
Thing, what's going on?
You crazy rabbit! What are you doing? Singing and dancing!
Are supposed to make people laugh.
Sit down!
You don't understand. A laugh can be a very powerful thing. Why, sometimes in life, it's the only weapon we have. Laughter is the most
Valiant looked through a peephole and saw Judge Doom and the Weasel standing in the bar.
I'm looking for a murderer.
A tune, Rabbit. About yay.
Look, there's no rabbit here, so don't harass my customers.
Say, boss, you always should disassemble the place.
No, Sergeant. Disassembling the place won't be necessary. The rabbit is going to come right to me. No tune can resist the old shave and a haircut trick.
In the back room, Valiant watched with horror as Roger began to shiver and sweat, desperately resisting the urge to give an answering knock.
Roger, no!
Shave and a haircut.
Help it!
Roger came bursting through the wall into the bar. Doom snatched him by the ears, grinning. Then he spotted Valiant through the hole in the wall.
We'll see to him later. Right now, I feel like an executioner. Bring me some dip.
The weasels wheeled in a dip tank. As one of them handed Judge Doom a pair of black rubber gloves, Valiant stepped forward.
Hey, Judge! Doesn't a dying rabbit deserve a last request?
Yeah, nose plugs would be nice.
I think you want a drink. How about it, Judge?
Huh? Well, why not? I don't mind prolonging the execution.
Happy trails.
No thanks, Eddie. I'm trying to cut down.
Drink the drink.
But I don't want the drink.
He doesn't want the drink.
He does.
I don't.
You do.
I don't.
You do.
I don't.
You do.
I don't.
You don't.
I do.
You don't.
I do.
You don't.
Listen, when I say I do, that means I do.
Suddenly, Roger's head turned into a steam whistle and let out an ear-piercing blast. In the confusion, Valiant grabbed Roger by the ears and raced out of the bar.
Boy, Eddie, that was quick thinking. That's not giving the old vine flower, the wise noodle, the smart pudding. Yes! Take it easy, will you, Eddie? Ah, my ears!
As they reached the street, Roger spotted a shiny yellow tomb taxicab shut inside the squad wagon.
They locked me up for driving on a sidewalk.
Come on, Eddie, get in.
It was just a couple of miles.
But I want to drive.
No, I'll drive. I'm the cab. Out of my way, pencil neck.
His tires squealing, Benny the cab roared off in a cloud of tomb dust. The weasels piled into the squad wagon and lurched off in pursuit. After a wild chase, Benny eluded them and pulled up in front of a movie theater, where he let his passengers out. Eddie and Roger ducked inside the theater, taking seats in the back row of the balcony. On the screen, a cartoon was just ending. Everyone in the audience howled with laughter, except Eddie Valiant.
Is there nothing that can permeate your impervious puss? Hey, Eddie! Boy, nothing. What could have possibly happened to you to turn you into such a sourpuss?
You want to know? I'll tell you. A tune killed my brother.
A tune? No.
That's right. A tune. We were investigating a robbery at the First National Bank of Toontown. Back in those days, me and Teddy liked working in Toontown. We thought it was a lot of laughs. Anyway, this guy got away with a zillion simoleons. We trailed into a little dive down on Yoxa Street. We went in. He got the drop on us. Literally. Dropped a piano on us from 15 stories. Broke my arm. Teddy never made it. I never did find out who that guy was. All I remember was he was standing over me laughing with those burning red eyes. That high, squeaky voice. He disappeared into Toontown after that. Nobody ever saw him again. Well, that's the story. I suppose you think that's funny, too.
No, Eddie. No wonder you hate me. If a toon killed my brother, I'd hate me, too.
Come on, don't cry. I don't hate you.
Yes, you do.
No, I don't.
You do hate me. Otherwise, you wouldn't have yanked my ears all those times.
All right, I'm sorry I yanked your ears.
Just then, someone slipped into the seat next to Valiant. It was Dolores.
Did you get all my stuff?
Yes. It's all packed up in the car outside. Would have been here right after you called, but I had to shake the weasels.
The newsreel came on, and they got up to leave.
California, Cloverleaf.
I'm glad Teddy's not here to see me running away with my tail between my legs.
It's not so bad once you get used to it.
The Pacific Red Car Trolley Line and the venerated Maroon Cartoon Studios. Here, R.K. Maroon is seen clinching the deal with Cloverleaf's bankers and execs in one of the biggest real estate deals ever in California history.
That's
it. $3.5 billion for a laugh factory.
That's the connection.
And that's no joke.
Connection? What connection?
Maroon doesn't want to buy Toontown. He wants to sell his studio. I bet Cloverleaf wouldn't buy the one without the other. That's why Maroon killed Acme.
What?
Well, don't you see? Maroon Studios is right next to the Acme factory, which is right next to Toontown. I figure this Cloverleaf outfit has plans for the whole piece of property.
What are they going to do with it?
There's only one guy that knows, and I'm going to make him tell me. R.K. Maroon, please. Eddie Valiant.
Eddie, he's not going to want to talk to you.
Oh, he's going to talk.
Mr. Maroon. Eddie Valiant. You got a bromo handy?
Later that evening, a car drove through the gates of Maroon Studios with its lights out. The car stopped and Eddie Valiant emerged. Roger Rabbit was next to him.
You told Maroon that you had the will, and you don't. When he finds out, he's gonna be mad. He might try to kill you.
I can handle a Hollywood cream puff. I just don't want the odds to change. So you cover my back. And if you hear or see anything, beat the horn twice.
Valiant disappeared into the building while Roger paced nervously beside the car.
That's it. Beat the horn twice. Cover your back. Boy, I'm ready. Took's up. I've peeled. Ears to the ground. Why, nobody gets a drop on Roger Rabbit.
A toon frying pan came crashing down on his head. Upstairs, R.K. Maroon looked up and saw Valiant walk into his office.
You got the will?
Sure, I got the will. Question is, do you have the way? Because I can tell you now, it ain't gonna come cheap.
Let me see that will.
I told you, I got it.
I wanna see it now!
How do I love thee? Let me count the ways. This is supposed to be a joke?
No, this... Get up. Come on.
What are you going to do to me, Valiant?
I'm going to listen to you spin the clover scenario.
Stop it! Stop it! Stop it! The truth is, I had a chance to sell my studio, but Cloverleaf wouldn't buy my property unless Acme sold him his. So I was gonna blackmail Acme with pictures of him and the rabbit's wife. Blackmail, that's all? I've been around Toons all my life. I didn't want to see him destroyed.
Toons destroyed? Why?
As Maroon opened his mouth to speak, a gun poked through the open window and shots rang out. Maroon crumpled to the floor. Valiant hurried to the window and saw Jessica Rabbit running across the parking lot. Valiant raced out of the building.
Roger!
He jumped into his car and followed Jessica's Packard through the Toontown tunnel. He lost sight of her somewhere in Toontown, but a few minutes later, spotted the Packard parked near an alley. He drew his gun and went in. As he moved deeper into the shadows, a figure stepped forward. It was Jessica Rabbit, and she was holding a gun.
I always knew I'd get it in Toontown.
Behind you!
She pulled the trigger, but Valiant was left standing. Behind him, a gun clattered to the ground.
Drop it, lady!
I just saved your life, and you still don't trust me?
I don't trust anybody or anything.
Not even your own eyes? That's the gun that killed R.K. Maroon, and Doom pulled the trigger.
Doom!
I followed him to the studio, but I was too late to stop him.
As they hurried out of the alley, Jessica stopped short and stared. The trunk of her Packard was open and the car was a wreck.
Oh, no. Where's Roger?
Roger? He chickened out on me back in the studio.
No, he didn't. I hit him on the head with a frying pan and put him in the trunk so he wouldn't get hurt.
Makes perfect sense.
We're obviously not going anywhere in my car. Let's take yours.
I got a feeling somebody already did.
He pointed to the spot where his car had been parked. The only thing left was a trail of destruction leading down the street and around the corner.
From the looks of it, I'd say it was Roger. My honey bunny was never very good behind the wheel. Uh-oh. It's the weasels. This way. We'll take Gingerbread Lane.
No, no! Gingerbread Lane's this way.
When Valiant stuck out his thumb, there was a rubber-burning screech as Benny the Cab appeared.
So, Valiant, you call a cab or what? Hubba, hubba, hubba. Mademoiselle.
They climbed in, and Benny rocketed off down the street, scattering weasels in every direction.
How long have you known it was Doom?
Before poor Marvin Acme was killed, he confided in me that Doom wanted to get his hands on Toontown, and he wouldn't stop at anything.
So he gave me the will for safekeeping?
That's what he told me, except when I opened the envelope, there was only a blank piece of paper inside.
The joke is to the end.
So where to already? My meat is running.
I have to find my darling husband. I'm so worried about him.
Seriously? What are you seeing that guy?
He makes me laugh.
Meanwhile, at the other end of the Toontown tunnel, a black boot kicked over a 10-gallon drum, spilling dip across the road. Judge Doom looked on, smiling as Benny came flying out of the tunnel. Benny's tires started smoking, then dissolved. He spun out of control and went crashing into a lamppost, throwing Valiant and Jessica onto the dirt. Judge Doom grabbed him, threw him into his car, and sped off into the night. Later, inside Acme's gag factory, Doom had the weasel search Valiant and Jessica for the will. When it didn't turn up, he looked at the clock.
I doubt if that will is going to show up in the next 15 minutes anyway.
What happens in the next 15 minutes?
Toontown will be legally mine, lock, stock, and barrel.
Across town, Roger emerged from Toontown Tunnel, driving a beat-up wreck that used to be Valiant's car.
Benny, is that you?
No, it's Shirley Temple.
Jumping jeepers, what happened?
Doom grabbed your wife and Valiant and took them to the Acme factory.
The Acme factory? I know where that is. Get in.
Move over, Raj. You've done enough driving for one night.
At the factory, Judge Doom explained his plan to Valiant.
I'm retiring. Take a new role in the private sector.
I won't be Cloverleaf Industries by any chance, huh?
You're looking at the sole stockholder.
As he spoke, the weasels were milling around a crane, a steamroller, and other construction equipment, all marked with a large green cloverleaf. Nearby, a huge modified tanker truck had been mounted with a giant spray gun.
Oh, my God, it's dead!
That's right, my dear! Enough to dip Toontown off the face of the earth! Vehicle of my own design. 5,000 gallons of heated dip. Pumped at enormous velocity through a pressurized water cannon. Toontown will be erased in a matter of minutes.
Outside the factory, Roger Rabbit was listening through a window where Benny the Cab had dropped him off a few minutes earlier. When he heard the judge's plan, he pulled out his gun, took a deep breath, and dove headfirst into the plumbing. On the floor of the factory, Jessica faced Judge Doom.
I suppose you think no one's going to notice Toontown's disappeared?
Who's got time to wonder what happened to some ridiculous talking mice when you're driving by at 75 miles an hour?
What are you talking about? There's no road past Toontown.
Not yet. Several months ago, I had the good providence to stumble upon this plan of the city council's. A construction plan of epic proportions. We're calling it a freeway.
Suddenly, Roger exploded out of a floor drain, sending the weasels flying. He landed on his feet and leveled his gun at Judge Doom.
Okay, nobody move. All right, weasel, grab some sky and let the judge have it. You heard me, I said drop it.
Roger, die!
Yes, it's me, my dearest. I'd love to embrace you, but first, I have to satisfy my sense of moral
outrage. Put that gun down, you buck-toothed fool!
Stop it, Doom! Give me another excuse, I'll pump you full of lead.
High on the rafters, one of Doom's helpers pushed a huge pile of bricks into place directly over Roger's head.
We too. But we're not stupid. We demand justice. Why, the real meaning of the word probably hits you like a ton of bricks.
Roger! Roger, say something.
Oh, stars! Ready when you are, Raoul.
Tyler, love birds together.
Judge Doom nodded toward Valiant.
You don't want his two friends get dipped and shoot him.
Doom turned and walked out the door. A few minutes later, Roger and Jessica were suspended beneath a giant crane directly in front of the dip spray gun. As the weasels prepared to open fire, Valiant found himself pushed up against an old calliope. He elbowed a button on the front, and the calliope began playing a familiar tune. The weasels watched in amazement as Valiant launched into an impromptu performance.
Now, Roger is his name. Laughter is his game. Come on, you dope, untie his rope and watch him go insane.
The weasels began giggling, then laughing, then howling hysterically. Jessica turned to Roger.
He's lost his mind.
I don't think so. Hey, Daddy, keep it up. You're killing him. You're slaying him. You're knocking him dead.
And that's exactly what was happening. The spectacle of this human acting like a toon was too much for the weasels to bear. One by one, they literally died laughing. The weasel manning the spray gun collapsed on the trigger, sending a spray of dip sweeping toward Roger and Jessica. Valiant raced toward the truck, dove, and knocked the spray gun to the side. As he did, a shadow descended over. Judge Doom had returned. Doom started the steamroller and pushed Valiant toward it. In desperation, Valiant reached for a can of Acme Stay Put adhesive and held it up in front of him. The judge put his fist right through it, then drew back and sent another punch flying. Valiant ducked. Doom's fist hit the steamroller and stuck, pulling the judge under the huge rolling drum. But instead of being crushed, the judge was rolled flat as a pancake. One edge curled up, and the whole shape peeled off the floor and wobbled to its feet.
Eddie, look!
He's a tomb!
Surprise?
Not really. That lame brain freeway idea could only be cooked up by a tomb.
Not just any tomb!
Doom staggered to an oxygen tank, stuck the valve in his mouth, and reinflated himself. His glasses cracked, his teeth shattered, and his false eyeballs popped out, revealing evil red toon eyes.
Remember me, Eddie? When I killed your brother, I talked just like this!
His hand turned into a buzzsaw, and he bore down on Valiant. Eddie looked around in desperation, and his gaze came to rest on one of Acme's spring-loaded boxing gloves. He grabbed it, pointed, and pulled the trigger. The glove accordioned out, punching a release lever on the dip trunk. A flood of dip gushed out of the valve and rolled in a giant wave toward Doom. This time, there was no escape. Judge Doom dissolved like a melted candle. Valiant lowered Roger and Jessica to the ground and untied them. Jessica threw her arms around her husband.
My hero. Oh, honey bunny.
Oh, love cup.
Oh, Roger, you were a pillar of strength.
As they embraced, the door opened, and Benny the Cab charged in, followed by Dolores, Baby Herman, Lieutenant Santino, and several other cops. Valiant gave Dolores a big hug, then looked down at the stain on his shirt.
Think. That goof acting squirted me in the side the other night. That's coming out now, don't you?
Roger picked up a bottle of ink off Marvin's desk and read the label.
Here's your answer, Eddie. Acme disappearing, reappearing ink. Boy, that Acme, what a genius!
Applesauce! If he was such a genius, why didn't he leave his will where we could find it? Without it, we're just waiting for another developer's wrecking ball.
Roger, that love letter you wrote to your wife in the Ink and Paint Club, why don't you read it to her now?
Sure, Eddie. Dear Jessica, how do I love thee? Let me count the wave. I, Marvin Acme, have sound mind and body. It's the real!
Keep reading.
Do hereby bequeath in perpetuity the property known as Toontown to those lovable characters, the Toons!
Later. Roger and Jessica, Eddie and Dolores, walked arm in arm out of the factory.
Do you think Toontown will still be around in, say, the next 30 or 40 years?
Yeah,
Toontown will always be around, if you know where to look for it.
Hey, Eddie, that was a pretty funny dance you did for the weasels. Do you think your days of being a sourpuss are over?
Only time will tell.
Yeah, well, put it there, pal. Don't tell me you lost your sense of humor already.
Does this answer your question?
Hey, Eddie, can you promise me just one little thing?
What's that, kid?
Don't ever kiss me on the lips again!